prison status. Don't have a place here. Viral obsessions fade, but you remain the same. Words and opinions are nothing but white noise. I only hear your voice. Light in the darkness, you are my heart's desire. Let my obsession be what you have done for me. In the end, what they think doesn't matter. I refuse to be bound to the standards. By your love, I am free. When the world is shouting,
our Friday night church service. At Eden 2.0, we are all about trying to strip Christianity back to its bare basics. This isn't about the person at the front. It's not about a massive worship band, lights and a stage. This is about each and every one of us experiencing the power of the presence of the Holy Spirit. We believe that only He can transform and change, and so we want to see Him alive and active and moving in our midst in powerful and miraculous ways. And so that's one of the key things that we value here at these evening meetings. We're also passionate about God's word. We believe that it is still for today and that the scriptures speak powerfully into our lives and our situation, and it's one of the primary ways in which we see the Spirit move. And then thirdly, we also want to be a community that is engaging with the world around us and with what is happening at the moment in wider culture, and wrestling with the questions that society is wrestling with, and holding up answers that are full of the Holy Spirit and full of the promises of God found in the scriptures. So guys, as you come to Eden 2.0 this evening, I ask and pray that you would not sit back and merely watch and be spectators, but come and get involved, come and participate. Let's do this together. Hi guys, welcome to Eden 2.0 this evening. Great to be with you. Tonight's going to be a little bit different. I just want to bring us a message about the power and the freedom of Jesus this evening. And I hope that this is going to be really relevant, not just for people that have been following Jesus for a long time, but maybe for those of you who have perhaps never followed Jesus before that might be watching this, either live or on catch up. So just encourage you, those of you that are starting to tune in, please, I mean, I don't profess that tonight's going to be particularly amazing or brilliant, but please share this with your friends and family, because I believe there's such power in these words that we're going to hear tonight to set people free. And so I want us to just, yeah, if we can share it with friends and family, you might want to share the post, you might want to send it to somebody on Messenger, you might want to even tag people in the comments so they can see it. And let's just share these words tonight so that people can encounter Jesus. The internet, Facebook, such a dark place. And yet there's so much light and life in these words that we're going to come to later. So please do be sharing this tonight with friends and family that don't know Jesus so they might experience his power. And I really do believe that that is something that we need this evening. And I'm jumping slightly ahead, actually. Before I kind of get to that, let me just pray for us before we kind of get there. And if you're watching this and you think that's weird, it's not that weird. You can close your eyes if you want to. Lift your hands up to him. And we're just going to pray that the God of the universe would speak to us tonight as we come into this digital space to meet with him. So, Father, I just pray, Lord, that you would come into this moment. Father, I thank you that perfect love casts out fear, and that, Lord, you have a power for us this evening that you want to reveal to us. And so, Lord, I just pray right now, would your spirit come into our homes, into our lounge, into our bedrooms, wherever we're watching this, Father, and would you meet with us, we pray, in power. Yes, Lord, come Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, it's that theme, I was jumping ahead there already, but it's that theme that I want to talk about tonight, this theme of power and fear. Because I think that as we kind of think about our lives in all sorts of different ways, we will all start to realize that there are things in our life which operate as powers over us that control us by fear. And that's exactly what I want to talk to us tonight. I think it's been really relevant because of what's been happening with the Black Lives Matters campaign, where we've seen that there is this idea that they've been showing us that has existed within society, that there are groups that are being oppressed and there are oppressors that are controlling people by fear because they're dominant powers. And I think that's a theme that has been shown by numerous groups to exist across society underneath this kind of name of critical theory. You may or may not know about that. I'm not going to get into the details of it, but I want to say tonight that there's a great deal of truth in what they say, that there are powers that control our lives by fear. And I don't want to get into the kind of debate about critical theory tonight, but I do want to say that I think that there's a lot of truth in it, but it also doesn't go far enough. And that actually for all of us, whether we're people of colour, whether we're white, whatever kind of background we're from, actually we all experience this to one degree or another, some of us far worse than others, of having powers over our life that start to control us. I wonder whether you've ever recognised that in your own life. And it could be something quite serious. It could be addictions to drugs or alcohol or pornography or something like that that becomes this power over your life that starts to control you by fear. You fear being without it, and you find yourself doing all kinds of crazy things to get it. Or it could be other things as well. It could be social media, for example. You know, you know that feeling when you post a photo up on Facebook or Instagram or a status, and you're there, you know, 5 minutes later, 10 minutes later, 15 minutes later, checking to see if anybody has liked it. And before you know it, social media has become this power that has an addictive nature. It's controlling your life by fear. You fear being without it, you fear being with it, you fear not being liked, and it starts to control you. It could be numerous other things. I think a massive one for people is reputation or people pleasing. We all want to be liked. We all want to be understood. We all want to be people that other people look up to in our workplace, in our family, and we want everybody to love us. Of course we do, but that can end up being something that starts to become a power over you that starts to control your life. And all of a sudden it starts to control your life by fear. You know, there are things that you are afraid of doing that you know that you should. There are things that you are afraid of saying that you know you should because you worry what other people might think of you, what other people might say, that nobody will like your photos on social media, that you won't be able to get hold of that thing that you need to satisfy your desires in terms of drugs or alcohol, because these things have become a power over our lives that controls us by fear. And I think that no matter who you are in life, you will have these things. you cannot escape them. There will almost certainly be things in your life that are powers over you that are controlling you by fear. The Black Lives Matter campaign has said that, you know, effectively what we need to do is get rid of those powers over us that control us, that oppress us, and then we will be free. And I do believe that much of what they were doing, but I also think that we cannot totally ever escape the fact that there will be things that are powers over our life that control us by fear. And the scary thing is, it's not a question of whether or not we've been controlled by fear, by these powers over us, but which ones are controlling us. And so you will have things in your life tonight that have been controlling you, and they actually can start to encase you in a cage where you can start to feel like that there are things you cannot do, there are places you cannot go, there are things you cannot say, there are dreams perhaps that you once used to have that you feel like you can't follow anymore because your life has been controlled by these powers that are dominating you. And the truth is, you might not ever apply for that job that you feel like you should because your fear says no. Or you might not ever have the courage to go and do that degree because your fear says no. You might not ever pick up that phone call because your fear says no. You might not ever have the confidence to share your faith with someone because your fear says no. You might not ever follow your dreams because your fear says no, because you're being controlled by people pleasing, by reputation, by career, by your friends and family, by drugs or alcohol, by pornography, by social media. And all these things have become powers over your life that are dominating you and holding you back from the things you want to do, from the things you feel like you should do, from the things that you are made to do. And tonight, the thing that I want to say to you is that it is about high time that we said to those powers over your life that are controlling you by fear, that they can go and pack their bags. Because somebody new is in charge, that Jesus Christ is here tonight in this digital space to set us free from those powers so that we might live the life of fullness that we were always supposed to live. We're free in Him. We're free in Him. And you might be watching this tonight having never known Jesus, never met Him, not even convinced or sure that He even exists. But something in what I'm saying is tantalizing and interesting. That's because it's true. And the truth is that for you tonight, as you're watching this, if you're addicted to your phone, if you're always worrying what people think about you, if you find that you're living a life of fear where it's almost like there's this soundtrack, Louis Giglio describes it like this. He says it's almost like there's this soundtrack over your life that because you're being controlled by social media, by your worrying about your reputation, by trying to uphold your career, or even your concerns about your own health and well-being, or it could be a mental health issue, that all of these powers control us by fear. And he says that it becomes like a soundtrack in our life that plays over and over again in the background that says you're not good enough. You're not able to do this. You'll come to nothing. You're not good enough. You're not able to do this. You'll come to nothing. You're not good enough. You're not able to do this. You'll come to nothing. Well, it's high time that we said in the name of Jesus that that soundtrack can just stop right now. Because there's a new power and there's a new authority that's here tonight to set us free. And I'm praying for you tonight as you're watching this, that you'll be set free as we come to look at this amazing story here in Mark's Gospel, where we see a man who has been dominated by a power. He's living a life of outrageous fear, and Jesus steps into his life and sets him free. And I'm praying for you tonight as you're watching this, that if you are in a situation where your life has been dominated by a power that's controlling you by fear and you feel trapped in a cage, there's things you can't do, there's places you can't go, then Jesus Christ will set you free just as he set this man free all those years ago. So let's turn to this story. Mark chapter 5. I'll put the passage in the description above. It says this. They came, and it's a story, okay, if you don't know already. They came to the other side of the sea, and this is Jesus and the disciples, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart. He bore the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. And when Jesus saw him from afar, he ran down and fell before him. And crying out in a loud voice, he said, What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me. come to the rest of the story in a minute and kind of have a look at some of the rest of it. But firstly, you might be kind of watching this, maybe you've never tuned into some of our stuff before, but you might be watching this, listening to that story, thinking, was that a story about a guy being possessed by a demon? Because that's a bit weird. And firstly, yes, it is a story of a guy being possessed by a demon, and yes, it is a bit weird. But part of the reason why I wanted to take you to this particular story is because I want to show you the extent of what it can look like when your life has been dominated by a power that's controlling you by fear. And this might actually resonate with some of the things that you've experienced in your life. It's an extreme example, but here is this guy. He's got this voice in his head that's controlling him, that's holding him back. It's telling him how to act, how to behave. It's trapping him in these chains, in this prison. Night and day, he's crying out in pain. Maybe that's something of what you have felt like in the past. And people have been trying to help him for years to get over this thing, and they've not been able to help him. And all the time, there have been these voices in his head telling him that he's worthless. You're not good enough. You can't do this. You'll come to nothing. So I think there's amazing amounts of parallels here, because this guy is in exactly the same situation that many of us will be in. There's a power dominating his life by fear. But the other thing I want to say is that this is real. And that might sound controversial to some of you, but this is really real. I think sometimes we read some of these stories in the Bible and we think, oh, well, maybe it was not really he wasn't really possessed by a demon. Maybe it was like a kind of mental health episode or something like that. And I do think that probably in the past there have been times when things were labeled as kind of demonic activity, which were actually a mental health issue. And sadly, people just didn't understand. But I don't think that's what we see here in this story. For lots of reasons, well, for one reason mainly in particular. And that's what happens when the man runs up to Jesus. Because here we have this man who's been living in the graves for a long, long time. He's been cut off by society. No one can talk to him. Nobody can get through to him. And yeah, and then he's been living in the graves. And then Jesus turns up in the graveyard. And the thing about Mark's gospel in the story so far is that people have been trying to kind of guess Jesus's true identity, and there's this kind of theme in the way that Mark's been writing it about nobody really knowing who Jesus actually is. Is he a political revolutionary? Is he a teacher? Is he a heretic? And everyone's trying to guess. And we know, as the readers reading it, that what Mark's trying to show us is that Jesus is actually the Son of God, but nobody's really kind of got that right yet so far. And so, bearing all of that in mind, bearing the mind in fact that Jesus has never been to this place before, met these people before, this man's been cut off from the whole of society, no one can talk to him, no one can get through to him, he just has to live in the graves. Look what happens in verse 6 when he runs up to him. It says, and we read it before, but he runs up to Jesus and he says, crying out in a loud voice, he says, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" So not only does this man who is possessed by demons know the name of Jesus, he also knows the identity of Jesus that nobody else knows. And that is why this is not a mental health issue, because a mental health issue does not help you to see into the supernatural, to see what no one else can see. The demons know that Jesus is God and they know his name. Nobody else does. And that's why this guy gets it. And that's why this is not a mental health thing. This is a spiritual power that is controlling this guy's life by fear. And actually, for some of you tonight, actually, maybe this is in fact your issue. It's a controversial thing to say in the West today in 2020. But in other parts of the world, this is incredibly normal. And that's not because they're like anti-scientific and they don't know anything. And, you know, that's just snobbery. Like, these are intelligent people in other societies, in other parts of the world, where this is just normal. And in fact, we do see this. You know, there's people in church I know who have told me stories about when they have been affected by these things. I know Brian, I'm sure he won't mind me mentioning, but he has an amazing story about, I mean, it's kind of a terrifying story as well, about how when he woke up in the middle of the night feeling like this thing was on his back, kind of clawing him, Janine had to like pray for him. And you'll have to ask Brian for the kind of full story, but it really happened. And I know other people that have said similar stories to me. Now, I don't think they're all making it up or imagining it, quite the opposite. They're sincere and they mean it. This stuff still happens. And so maybe the power that is controlling you of your life has actually something of a supernatural about it as well. Well, either way, whether it's social media, whether it's reputation,
Whether it's alcohol, drugs, or something supernatural controlling your life, the same thing is true as was true for this man, and that's that Jesus Christ can set you free. But by coming to this story, I want to show you that tonight I am not underestimating the situation that you're in. It can look really, really, really desperate when you're controlled by this kind of power that's holding you down in fear. I mean, look at this guy. He had it really bad, didn't he? I think verse 9. Let's skip down to verse 9. Jesus said to him, "What is your name?" And he replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And the word the name Legion was a kind of term for part of a Roman army for 5,000 men. So effectively, this guy has got 5,000 demons living in him, all chanting that same soundtrack over and over again. "You're not good enough. You'll come to nothing. You'll never make it." 5,000 of them saying this kind of stuff to him. And you might think that you have got lots of problems, you know, in your life. You might think, you know, "I've got multiple things controlling my life. Yes, I do just worry far too much about what people think of me. Yes, I have an addiction to social media. Yes, I have an addiction to something else. Maybe it's alcohol, maybe it's drugs, maybe it's pornography, maybe it's something else." There's all these things. You might have 99 things that are controlling your life. But this guy's got 5,000 things that are controlling his life and having power over him. But look, Jesus ain't one. Look what happens when the guy meets Jesus. Verse 10. And this is what happens. And when they talked to Jesus, and they begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. So look, guys, I don't care tonight what fears are controlling you. Whether it's any of the things I've mentioned so far, something I've not mentioned, whether it's supernatural, you probably know already what it is that's holding you back and controlling you and your life, what you're most afraid of. Like, it has no power compared to the power of Jesus. And so I rebuke it now in the name of Jesus. May it no longer hold you down anymore. All 5,000 of your addictions, of your worries, of your bad thoughts, may they go fleeing. May they just beg in the presence of Jesus this evening. And why? Because when Jesus shows up on the scene and he steps into your story, as he steps into this man's story, he steps in as the greatest power of them all, as the guy that created the whole universe, flung stars into space, heats the sun, created the planet, created every single star on every single night, at the end of every single day. He made it all. He's the undisputed heavyweight champion of the cosmos. He made every single thing. Doesn't that ever blow your mind? And that's why, when he steps into your life as a greater power, these lesser powers like these demons will come begging. And just look what happens with the guy afterwards, as his demons meet Jesus and they come begging. They leave him, and then in verse 15, "And they came to Jesus," this is the townspeople, "they came to Jesus and they saw the demon-possessed man who had the legion sitting there clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid." We'll get to that bit in a minute about them being afraid. But do you see, he's just sat there after this ordeal, and it says he's clothed, you know, because I think he would have been naked for this whole time because he wouldn't have even been able to put on clothes. And he's in his right mind. Like, isn't this beautiful? I kind of imagine, you know, the disciples would have been there helping him put shoes on his feet, a coat on his back for the first time. I would imagine, you know, even that night he would have gone back with the disciples and maybe just had a meal. For the first time ever, he just gets a Chinese with the guys and he hangs out, and his life is restored and it's put back together. Isn't this just kind of beautiful? But at the same time, do you see what happens with the townspeople? They were afraid. They were afraid, and I think first they're angry, and you know, the farmers are angry, the pigs have died, the vegan activists probably all come out there angry as well because the pigs have died. I mean, I'm like, come on, this guy's been set free. It's kind of, I get it, but he's been set free. But anyway, they also see him, and this is what really bothers them. First, they come because they're angry about the pigs. Secondly, they see this guy sat there dressed in his right mind, and they think, man, this guy, we've been trying to help him for years. We've tried everything. We tried everything to help him get better. We did what we could, and now you know, and I mean, just rewind, it must have got slightly desperate because they'd actually gotten to the point where they just locked him in a graveyard. I mean, things, that's pretty bad. Things get pretty bad when you know you have to kind of lock someone in a graveyard to deal with their problems. But that's what they had to do with this guy. And yet now they come up to him and they see him sat dressed there and in his right mind, and they are scared. They're scared of Jesus. Because all of a sudden they have discovered that here was this power that they could not control, that seemed like it was too big for them, this legion of 5,000 that was beyond their control, and now all of a sudden it's gone because a greater power has turned up on the scene, and so they're afraid. And it's natural, because fear is just what happens when a bigger power meets a smaller power. Like when you pull up to your traffic light, when you pull up to the traffic lights and you're like 1.1 litre Vauxhall Corsa, and you look to the right and there's a guy there sat in a Ferrari, and he kind of looks at you and gives you the kind of nod to say the race is on. You know what happens in that moment? Fear is what happens every time a lesser power meets a greater power. That's why you so struggle in your life and are controlled by fears, because you are a small power. And some of these other things are much greater and more powerful things than you are, which is why fear happens. So, you know, it happens every time. For example, when a rabbit meets a fox, what does the rabbit feel in that moment when it meets a fox? Fear. But hang on, this is really important. When a rabbit meets a fox, the rabbit feels fear. But when the fox meets a lion, what do you think the rabbit does? The rabbit laughs, okay? When a fox meets a lion, the rabbit laughs. And just follow me for a minute. You know, you have this soundtrack in your life. You're not good enough. You'll come to nothing. You'll never be able to do this. You have this soundtrack in your life because you are a rabbit. You are a rabbit and you're being chased by these foxes. Foxes of addiction, foxes of phobias, social media, relationships, people pleasing, addictions, whatever it is in your life that's controlling you, it's chasing you like a fox, and you're like a poor little rabbit running away and running away and running away. But when Jesus shows up in your life, he shows up like a lion. And you know what the rabbit does when the lion shows up and the foxes run away? The rabbit laughs. He laughs because Jesus is more powerful than the foxes, so the foxes run away. And now you're in the situation where you are a rabbit who's made friends with a lion. And so that's important, right? Because you're still scared, right? Because the lion is bigger than you. He's more powerful than you. When a smaller power meets a greater power, what happens is fear. But this is a different kind of fear, because you know that the lion is not going to eat you. Okay, it's like in Narnia. Do you remember when Susan says about Aslan, he's... is he safe? And I think the beaver says to Susan, is he safe? And Susan says, he's not safe, but he's good. And that's the same thing with Jesus. He's not safe, but he's good. He's not tame. He's still a bigger power than you. You still approach him with fear. But the difference is now is that in relationship with him, you find freedom, right? Because you know that he won't harm you, but yet when he moves, you move, because you know you have to stay with him. When he stops, you stop, because you know you have to stay with him. When he goes, you go, because you know that in him is freedom, and in him is safety, and in him is peace. Okay? And so you listen to what he says, you do what he says that you need to do. And the thing you have to realize as a rabbit is, because you are weak and because you are powerless, which we all have to come to terms with, we will always be controlled by powers that will exert fear over us. And you choose. It can be relationships, it can be failure, it can be family, it can be finances, it can be health. Or you can make Jesus the lion the only power in your life, your only fear. And then all these foxes that have been chasing after you for so long will run away, because all of a sudden there's a greater power in your life. And what happens is, when they're chasing you, you know, the foxes with their soundtrack make you feel smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. But the more time that you spend with Jesus, even though you're still a little rabbit, because you're living life next to a lion, you start to feel bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, because you're living next to him. But before I finish, I just want to tell you something else really, really important. And that's this, is that actually that soundtrack in the back of your life, you're not good enough, you'll come to nothing, you'll never be able to do this. The thing is, much of that soundtrack is probably true, and we have to come to terms with that. But knowing Jesus is the lion deals with that as well. There's much of it that's true, because let's be honest, most of us are kind of weak and pathetic, and because actually we are moral failures, and there are lots of things that we know we should be able to do that we just can't do. we're pretty rubbish people, and we let people down all the time. We're not good. And so that's partly why that soundtrack hurts so much, because there's so much truth in it. But Jesus the Lion, he knows that there is much truth in the soundtrack that the foxes are blaring out over your life. And so he steps into this world and he lets humanity kill him. He takes onto himself your soundtrack and the truth behind it. He takes on all of your failures, all of your misunderstandings, all of the times that you've let people down, and all of the wrong things that you do. He takes all of that soundtrack and the truth behind that soundtrack, and he takes it to the grave with him. And he's strung up there on a cross. And as he dies, the most gruesome of deaths, what happens is that the soundtrack of his life gets ejected. And if you're willing to say to Jesus, "Jesus, have my life," then as he dies, what happens is he takes on your soundtrack and your pain and the wrong things that you've done and your moral failures. He takes on not just your soundtrack, but the truth behind that soundtrack, and he takes it to the grave and he ejects his own and he gives it to you. And all of a sudden, it's like, you know, one CD, one tape gets taken out, another one gets put in, and all of a sudden you're not listening to the same soundtrack anymore that's playing back your own moral failures, but you're listening to the soundtrack that's playing back to you the righteousness and the goodness and the holiness of Jesus. And man, is it a very different soundtrack to listen to. It says this: you are powerful, you are a child of God, demons cannot touch you, every fear is a lie, you're safe in my arms, there is peace, there is understanding, you're loved, you're cherished, you're understood, you're known, I've counted the hairs upon your head, there's a future for you, an inheritance for you, you'll be safe forever in me. And you start listening to that over and over and over again. It sounds very different from listening to the soundtrack of your own moral failures. But the only way in which you can ever access that, the soundtrack of the Lion playing in your life, is if you come to Jesus and you say, "Take my life from me so that I might have yours." And in this amazing, amazing act of love, Jesus hangs there on the cross and he becomes weak so that you might become strong. He gets ripped apart in that moment so that you might get put back together. He takes on all of your fears, all of your failures, all of your misunderstandings, all of your moral shortcomings, and he takes them to the grave and he swaps them for his own life. And here's the thing, that means that next time those foxes come after you, you know, social media, health, family pressure, finances, bills, all trying to pin you down with their fear, next time those foxes come chasing after you, they're in for one heck of a shock. Because now that your life is in Christ, next time they show up, all of a sudden you're not a rabbit anymore. You're like 200 kilograms. You're like golden fur. You're like claws and teeth. Because all of a sudden, it's not just that you are living life as a rabbit next to a lion, but in Christ you have become the Lion. You're living inside of him and he's living inside of you by the power of his Holy Spirit. Oh, it's amazing, isn't it? The power that rose Jesus Christ from the grave is living inside of you when you come and put your trust and your life in him. And it's yours tonight. You know, I think what we need in the UK at this moment is not a dismantling of authority and power in order for us to find freedom and find peace. What we need is a new authority, a new power. Someone who loves us and cares for us and gives himself up for us. And you know, when you start to live inside of that and know it, it is just awesome. It's just awesome, you know. There's so many things at the moment that we're scared of, that we're afraid of, that are coming up against us, anxieties on every single side, things trying to have power and control over our lives, coronavirus. But when you're safe in Jesus, can't touch me. I know I'm in him. Whatever comes against me, I know I'll be safe. That I've got a future, I've got an inheritance, and that's the soundtrack that I'm now listening to in this moment. I'm untouchable. I've got a hope in something beyond this world. You know, I recently found out that I'm kind of going through the diagnosis at the moment, but I've got this thing called spondylitis. It's like a pain in my body, mainly in my back and in my neck, and I wake up every morning, feels like I've just run a marathon the day before, often exhausted and just in an awful lot of pain. And I know that, like, chances are in the future, if that is what's causing this pain, then it might even cause my spine to start to fuse together and my neck to fuse together in one particular place. And Alicia's been like, I can't believe you're not more bothered about this. A few people said that, like, I can't believe you've not been more bothered about that as kind of potentially being what happens to you. And I'm like, well, I'd rather it didn't happen, but also it doesn't bother me because I'm not scared and I'm not worried. I can face whatever happens to me in life because I know that I'm not living inside of my own rabbit-like weakness anymore. I'm living inside the life of a lion. And that I have a future in him that is just providing me with a hope that nothing else can provide me with. So, yeah, that health worry can't get me down. Because I know that one day Jesus Christ will come back as the great lion and he will destroy every single fox forever. He'll wipe away every tear. He'll restore everything. He'll make it all new. And that's not to say I don't have dark days where those thoughts come and bite me and I do get scared and I do worry. Of course I do, I'm being realistic here. But then I turn my mind back to him. I come into his presence before him. I seek his face. I get to know him and read about him and have a relationship with him. And as I do, that soundtrack comes back to me over and over again. The soundtrack of Jesus Christ. That because of his work on the cross, my guilt and my shame is taken away. And his honour and his glory is given to me. I am perfect, I am great, I am powerful. I am a child of God. Nothing can touch me. I'm free forever. I'm his. And the truth is, guys, as you're watching this tonight, maybe you've never kind of thought about Christianity in that way. Maybe you've always thought it was just dry meetings and boring books. And people that were just like, have bigoted opinions about things. But it's none of those things. It's about being set free from all of the pain and all of the anxiety that exists in our lives, which is so often actually caused by ourselves. And finding a hope, a security and a peace in giving glory and thanks and coming under the authority of the one who knows us and made us. Realizing we're living life with a lion, moving when he moves, going when he goes, stopping when he stops, staying in his presence, because in his presence there is freedom. That's what Christianity is all about. And it can be yours tonight. Jesus is there on that cross, dying for you with his arms open wide in invitation. And he says to you this evening, you know, come to me, all you who are weary, and I will give you rest. And maybe you are just fed up of the anxiety and the fear and the shame that surrounds you in life, and you're desperate for something to get you out of this. Well, Jesus is there and he's ready and he's waiting for you and he's asking you to invite him into your life. Maybe you did that years ago, maybe you've never done that, maybe you need to redo that again. Well, tonight I just want to say, what on earth are you waiting for? This life is free, it's on offer now. Be on offer tomorrow, but don't put it off. It's here for you right now. There is nothing that should hold you back from accepting him. You might still have questions. We all still have questions. No Christian I've ever met is free from doubts and worries about what it means to be a Christian. So you don't have to wait until you've got everything right. This is for those that are broken, for those that are doubting, for those that don't understand everything, but for those who are desperate to be set free from fear and shame. Jesus is opening an invitation to you this evening. I just encourage you, what on earth is stopping you from taking it? It might be the kind of scariest thing that you've ever done, but it will also be the best thing you've ever done. It's not like it's free from cost. There's a cost to it, to living in his presence and staying next to the lion. It's not easy, but it's the greatest and the best adventure that you will ever go on. And so I just encourage you, I'm going to pray a prayer now. And if you want to accept Jesus into your life, to live this life of freedom from those things, those powers in your life that are controlling you by fear, then you're able to do that tonight. And I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you want to just pray it with me, then just echo these words in your mind, in your head. Say amen with me at the end and welcome Jesus into your life. So here we go. Father, I thank you that you accept us as we are. with all of our shame, with all of our failures, with all of our weakness, that Father, you accept us with that soundtrack of shame over our lives, and Father, you accept us with the truth behind that soundtrack, that we really are weak and unable. But Lord, we don't want to live in fear anymore of things trying to get control of us. And so, Father, we just give ourselves into your arms. Father, we're sorry for all of our shortcomings. And we know that we need you. We thank you for Jesus' death on the cross. And so, Lord, we just invite you now to come into our lives, to change us, to renew us, to make us new and whole again. Lord, would you transform us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, guys, if you did pray that prayer with me, maybe for the first time, maybe as a recommitment, then please send a message into our Facebook group, send a message into our Facebook page. We would love to hear from you and be with you to support you on this journey and come alongside you and just help you to walk in the truth of what we've been talking about tonight. We don't want to just be judgmental or unwelcoming in any way. It doesn't matter where you've come from, how you're feeling, how you ended up watching this video. We're here to help you in any way that we possibly can. So please get in touch and we will try to support and help you in any way. Guys, that's been it from me this evening, but it's been great to kind of hang out with you tonight and share in this message with you together. I'm going to put on a worship song at the end here just to finish. You might want to just use that now to come before God and engage with him. And just give over to him some of the shame, some of the fears that have been holding you back.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead.
Open up my eyes in wonder.
It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love.
Open up my eyes and wonder.